We've seen that a function maps elements from its domain. If you give it an element in its domain, it will then map it to an element in its range. So for example, if this is the domain, let me do this in this orange color. If this is the domain of a function, and let me just pick out some random elements right over here. So let's say that this is 1, this is -1, this is 7, and this is pi. Let's say these are all members of the domain of f. And let's say that f, and let's say that this right over here is the range. So this is right over here is the range. And so let's say that f of 1, so if you input 1 into the function, the function maps 1 to the number -3. And let's say it maps the number -1, so f of -1 is equal to 7. And let's say that f of 7 is equal to 10. But let's say that f of pi is also equal to 10. So this is the function mapping, and this is a legitimate function. Remember, in order to be a function, for any input, it has to map it to a unique, it needs to map it to only one output. This wouldn't be a function if it did something like this. If you input pi, instead of saying you're going to get 10, instead of saying that f of pi is equal to 10, this is clearly a function. You're mapping from pi to 10. For the input pi, you know you're going to get the output 10. But if you were doing some type of a relationship where you said, oh, well, if you put in a pi, sometimes it's a 10 and sometimes it's an 11. Now, this would not be a function because you're mapping pi to two different values right over here. So that's not allowed if you're thinking about a function. For any input, you have to map it to only one output. Now, you could have two inputs that map to the same output because this is predictable. You know that f of 7 is 10 and you know that f of pi is 10. But what I want to do is now think about when does a function when is it not invertible? We've already seen that the inverse of a function should map between an element of its range and the corresponding element in the domain. So the inverse of f should map -3 to 1. So f inverse. So because f of 1, actually let me write it this way. Actually, I'll just write it. Because if f of 1 was equal to -3, f inverse of -3, and the inverse function is also a function. So it has to have the same properties of a function. It should map to only one thing. F inverse of -3 is going to be equal to 1. F inverse of 7 is going to be equal to -1. F inverse right over here. But now we have something strange happening. If we think about, let me write this down. F inverse of 7 is equal to -1. That makes sense because we already knew that f of -1 is equal to 7. But now something interesting happens over here. What would f inverse of 10 be? Well, f inverse of 10, if I'm trying to map it, 10, there's two elements in the domain that when I applied the function got us to 10 in the range. So if you're trying to see whether f is invertible, then the inverse function should map this element to only one element of the domain. But it's mapping it to two elements of the domain. So is this equal to 7? Or is this equal to pi? And because the inverse mapping can't be done where you only map it with a unique thing, this function is not invertible. This is not invertible. The inverse mapping from the range to the domain, the inverse relationship, is not a function. It can't take an element in our range and map it to a unique element of the domain. For 10, we don't know, does that map to pi or does that map to 7? So this function, f is a function. For any member of its domain, it's a very well-defined element in the range, but the other way around isn't true. For the inverse function, for any element in this set, it doesn't go to only one element in that set. This 10 could be mapped to either pi or 7. So f inverse, so another way to think about it, this is not an invertible f. F is not invertible. F is a function, but the inverse mapping is not a function, so we would say that f is not invertible.